Hello, good evening. Last class, we just started complex numbers. After starting complex numbers, we were discussing so many aspects. We defined a modulus, amplitude, conjugate, organ diagram, all the things we have defined. Not today. Today, let us take one example to find a modulus and amplitude. Consider z is equal to minus 3 plus 4i. This complex number is represented by the coordinates minus 3, comma 4. Minus 3 comma 4. Minus 3 comma 4 is in the second quadrant. Is in the second quadrant. If you represent point P here, minus 3, 4, the distance of that point from the origin is the modulus. Automatically, if you draw this, this is 3 units. Since it is measured in the negative direction, minus 3, this is 4 units. So therefore, automatically, this is 3 units. For practical purpose, we say it is 3 units. Tan alpha is, this is alpha, tan alpha is 4 by 3. So modulus z is root of 3 square plus 4 square, 9 plus 16, you get root 25, 5. So modulus of this complex number, modulus of this complex number is 5 units. It's very simple. Or in general, given any complex number a plus ib, a plus ib, we all know modulus of z is nothing but square root of a square plus b square. It may be in the first quadrant or second quadrant or third quadrant or fourth quadrant. Okay. Now, modulus z we have found. Coming to amplitude, in fact, this is our amplitude. This is the amplitude of this complex number, minus 3 plus 4i, which is represented by the point minus 3, 4. So, this is the amplitude. This angle is the amplitude. You take tan alpha is 4 by 3. Find alpha. If you take tan alpha is 4 by 3. If you take tan alpha is 4 by 3. Find alpha. You get alpha as 53 degrees, 8 minutes from the table. If tan alpha is 4 by 3, from the natural tangents we get alpha as 53 degrees, 8 minutes. Now, we want argument, this is the argument or amplitude, which is nothing but 180 minus alpha. 180 minus 53 degrees, 8 minutes, you get 126 degrees, 52 minutes. So, therefore, the amplitude, that is theta, which is in the second quadrant, should be above 90, that gives 126 degrees, 52 minutes. So therefore, this is the amplitude, this is the modulus. So modulus is 5 units, amplitude is 126 degrees, approximately 126 degrees, we can say. So, for complex numbers lying in the first quadrant, amplitude lies between 0 and pi by 2. If it is the second quadrant, pi by 2 and pi. Third quadrant, pi and 3 pi by 2. 3 pi by 2 and 2 pi if it is in the fourth quadrant. We can also measure like this. That is also allowed. Okay. Now, we can, once you know modulus amplitude, we are seeing the addition of complex numbers, a representation of addition of two complex numbers. Okay, let us have a very good explanation like this. We all know this is organ diagram. This is the organ diagram. You take a complex number z1, a1 plus ib1. Understand this carefully, it will be very useful. Z2, another complex number, a2 plus ib2. So there are two complex numbers, a1 plus ib1, a2 plus ib2. Last class we have seen how to add two complex numbers, z1 plus z2 is a1 plus a2 plus I times b1 plus b2. I times b1 plus b2. Therefore, if you represent complex number by a1 b1, suppose I am representing the complex number by the coordinates a1 b1, this is z1. Another complex number z2 represented by a2 b2, represented by a2 b2, a1 b1, a2 b2, because a1 b1, a2 b2. You complete the parallelogram having these two as adjacent sides. You take this point as P, this point as Q. You complete this parallelogram having these two as adjacent sides. Then this point R represents sum of two complex numbers, namely Z1 plus Z2. This point R represents sum of two complex numbers, Z1 plus Z2. That is, coordinates A1 plus A2, comma B1 plus B2. So the point R gives the coordinates A1 plus A2, B1 plus B2. So therefore, if two complex numbers are represented by OP and OQ, that is P and Q are two complex numbers, then automatically you complete the parallelogram OPRQ, then this point R represents sum of two complex numbers in the Argand diagram. Geometrically, it can be proved that point R is nothing but Z1 plus Z2. That is giving the coordinates A1 plus A2, B1 plus A2. Okay. Now, once you represent the complex number in the Argand diagram, this is a form of P, this is Q. P, this is Q, this is R. Then automatically, if this is Z1, this is mod Z1. If this is Z2, this is mod Z2. That is OQ is mod Z2. So by automatically OR is mod Z1 plus Z2. Z2, R is Z1 plus Z2. R represents Z1 plus Z2. Now, if you draw a triangle, that is, if you imagine a triangle OPR, so we can get that figure itself. This is Z1, Z2, Z1 plus Z2. This is mod Z1, this is mod Z2, that is, this is also mod Z2. From triangle OPR, we know in any triangle, sum of two sides is always greater than third side. Mod Z1 plus mod Z2, mod Z1 plus mod Z2 is greater than or equal to this third side is OR, mod Z1 plus Z2. This is mod Z1 plus Z2. It is mod Z1 plus Z2. Therefore, mod Z1 plus mod Z2 is greater than mod Z1 plus Z2. Sum of two sides is greater than the third side. Sum of these two sides is greater than the third side. That is the geometrical result. Therefore, we can write mod Z1 plus mod Z2 as less than mod Z1 plus mod Z2. In general, mod Z1 plus Z2 is less than mod Z1 plus mod Z2. I am reverting. That is, I am taking left hand side, right hand side is it. Then automatically inequality is reversed. Now, mod Z1 plus Z2 is less than mod Z1 plus mod Z2. We can easily observe that. If Z1, Z2, Z1 plus Z2 are all collinear with the origin, that is very important. Not only collinear, that condition is not important, collinear with the origin. Even here, the complex numbers can be here, even they are collinear, but they are not collinear with the origin. Here, Z1, Z2 are collinear with the origin. Then automatically, Z1 plus Z2 is also collinear with that, Z1 and Z2. So therefore, automatically, when Z1 and Z2 are collinear with the origin, Z1 plus Z2 also lies on that straight line. For example, if you take, 1 plus I, 1 plus I is here, 2 plus 2I is here, and 3 plus 3I will be here. They are all lying on the line, Y is equal to X. You can easily verify. 1 plus I, 2 plus 2I, 3 plus 3I, They are all lying on the same straight line. I will draw, I'll write it clearly. 1 plus I, 2 plus 2i, 3 plus 3i. Z1 is 1 plus I. Then mod Z1 is root 2. Z2 is 2 plus 2i. Mod Z2, you get 2 root 2, because you get root 8, root of 4 plus 4, root 8, you get 2 root 2. And Z1 plus Z2 is nothing but 3 plus 3i, mod Z1 plus Z2 is equal to root of 9 plus 9, 18, you get 3 root 2. We can easily see that mod Z1 plus mod Z2 is equal to mod Z1 plus Z2 in this case. And which case? Mod Z1 plus mod Z2 is equal to mod Z1 plus Z2. We can immediately say modulus of Z1 plus Z2 is equal to mod Z1 plus mod Z2. Only when Z1, Z2, Z3 are, Z1, Z2 are collinear with the origin. Z1 and Z2 are collinear with the origin. So, Z1 plus Z2 modulus is equal to mod Z1 plus mod Z2 only when Z1 and Z2 are collinear with the origin. Now, suppose even if you take I, 2i, I, 2i, 3i. So, modulus I is 1, mod 2i is 2, mod 3i is 3. So, Z1 plus Z2, mod Z1 plus mod Z2 is mod Z1 plus Z2. They are all collinear with the origin. Anywhere you can take. We can take two complex numbers here, like that. So therefore, mod Z1 plus Z2 is equal to mod Z1 plus mod Z2. Only when Z1, Z2 are collinear with the origin. So this result, mod Z1 plus mod Z2. So just to make a correction, mod Z1 plus mod Z2. Mod Z1 plus Z2 is less than or equal to mod Z1 plus mod Z2. Mod Z1 plus Z2 is equal to mod Z1 plus mod Z2 only when Z1 and Z2 are collinear with the origin. Combining these two, we get mod Z1 plus Z2 is always less than or equal to mod Z1 plus mod Z2. We are getting one inequality. We call this as triangular inequality. I repeat again, when Z1 and Z2 are two complex numbers, Z1 is represented by this point, Z2 is represented by this point, automatically complete the parallelogram. This point represents Z1 plus Z2. This is mod Z1, this is mod Z2, this is mod Z1 plus Z2. Sum of two sides is always greater than third side. Mod Z1 plus mod Z2 is greater than mod Z1 plus Z2. Or in other words, modulus of Z1 plus Z2 is less than mod Z1 plus mod Z2. But modulus of Z1 plus Z2 is equal to mod Z1 plus mod Z2 when Z1 and Z2 are fully of the origin. Combining the two, that is combining this result and this result, mod Z1 plus Z2 is less than or equal to mod Z1 plus mod Z2. This is addition. Suppose, how do you represent difference of two complex numbers? How do you represent difference of two complex numbers? When Z1 is here, Z2 is here, you draw a line, through the origin, draw the same distance you cover, then automatically this point represents minus Z2. When this is Z2, this is minus Z2. This is minus Z2. This is Z1, this is minus Z2. Complete this parallelogram. So here this becomes a, this becomes addition of these two. Is Z1, this is minus Z2. Adding you get Z1 minus Z2. Therefore, this is a point R dash representing Z1 minus Z2. Z1 minus Z2. So automatically this is nothing but mod Z1 minus Z2. Mod Z1 minus Z2. This is mod Z1, mod Z2, mod Z1 minus Z2. Even here, sum of two sides, this side plus this side, is greater than this. Mod Z1 plus mod Z2 is greater than mod Z1 minus Z2. So again, same condition satisfies here. Mod Z1 minus Z2 is less than or equal to mod Z1 plus mod Z2. So mod Z1 plus Z2 is less than or equal to mod Z1 plus mod Z2. Mod Z1 minus Z2 is also less than or equal to mod Z1 plus mod Z. Therefore, combining these two, we get this result. This is very, very important result. This is called famous triangular inequality. I repeat again from the figure. To find Z1 minus Z2, you extend this. To find Z2 minus Z1, you extend this. You extend Z1 and get minus Z1. You mark it, complete the parallelogram, do it, you can understand. This is Z1 plus Z2, this is Z1 minus Z2. So again, applying that triangle, in a triangle, sum of two sides is always greater than third side, you get that result as well as this result. This is called famous triangular inequality. Okay. We can also represent a product of two complex numbers in the organ diagram. After finishing all the theoretical part, we'll solve some interesting problems, IIT problems we are solving. The product of two complex numbers. So before that, you must know, any complex number can be represented in the form R into cos theta plus I sin theta. Any complex number can be represented in the form R into cos theta plus I sin theta. Here R is called modulus of the complex number Z, and theta is called amplitude. Theta is called amplitude of the complex number. Once you represent a complex number in this form, R into cos theta plus I sin theta, R is called modulus, theta is called amplitude. For example, you can take 1 plus I. You can take 1 plus I. We can write 1 plus I as root 2 into cos pi by 4 plus I sin pi by 4. Cos pi by 4 plus I sin pi by 4. Cos pi by 4 is 1 by root 2. I by 4 is 1 by root 2, bring root 2 inside, you get root 2, root 2 gets cancelled, 1 plus I, we get this. Here root 2 is the modulus of this complex number, 1 plus I, pi by 4, so pi by 4, root 2, modulus of this complex number is nothing but root 2, and amplitude of this complex number is pi by 4. So therefore, for any complex number, we can find modulus and amplitude. This is called modulus amplitude form of a complex number Z. I'll give another example. Z is equal to 1 plus root 3i. 1 plus root 3i. We can find a modulus amplitude form of this. That is R into cos theta plus I sin theta. Every complex number can be represented in this form, R into cos theta plus I sin theta. Equating real part, you get R cos theta is equal to 1. Equating real part, R cos theta is 1. Equating imaginary part, R sin theta is equal to root 3. Squaring and adding, R square into cos square theta plus sin square theta, 1. Therefore, R square is equal to 1 plus 3, you get 4. Therefore, R is nothing but 2. 2 stands for positive square root, because modulus is always positive. Therefore, automatically R is equal to 2. So, in the place of R, I have written 2. Now, once r is 2, we get from this cos theta is equal to 1 by 2. R is 2. Sin theta is equal to root 3 by 2. Sin theta is equal to root 3 by 2. So, what's the conclusion? The conclusion is cos theta is positive, sin theta is positive. Therefore, theta must be 60 degrees or pi by 3 radians. Because we know cos 60 is half, sin 60 is root 3 by 2. So that implies theta is equal to pi by, say, 3. Pi by 3. Cos 60, therefore, theta is equal to pi by 3. Pi by 3. Now, once theta is known, we can write here cos pi by 3 plus I sin pi by 3. Here cos 60 is half, you write half here, root 3 by 2 here, bring 2 inside, you get 1 plus root 3. So therefore, this is the modulus amplitude form of 1 plus root 3 I. Similarly, we can get a modulus amplitude form of root 3 plus I. These are the standard complex number. So here 2 times cos pi by 6 plus I sin pi by 6. I sin pi by 6. So this is the modulus amplitude form of root 3 plus I. Now you must know, when the complex number is purely real, when the complex number is purely real, for example, you take 3. 3 is a complex number, which is purely real. Imaginary part is 0. So once a complex number is purely real, 3 exactly lies on the real axis. So therefore, we can write modulus as 3, amplitude is 0 because the inclination is 0, you get cos 0 plus I sin 0. Cos 0 is 1, sin 0 is 0, we get exactly 3. So this is the modulus amplitude form of 3. Modulus. Suppose you are having a complex number 2i here. We are having a modulus, 2i is a complex number. When 2i is there, when 2i is here, we get 2i. Then 2i can be written as 2i. That is 2 times, we can write modulus amplitude form of the complex number I. So I is nothing but, automatically amplitude is pi by 2. That modulus is 2. For I it is 1. You get cos pi by 2 plus I sin pi by 2. Cos pi by 2 plus I sin pi by 2. So therefore, 2 is a modulus, pi by 2 is a cos 90, sin 90 is 1, cos 90 is 0. You get exactly 2i. You get exactly 2i. So modulus is 2, amplitude is pi by 2. So we can get modulus amplitude of any complex number easily. Suppose the complex number lies on the negative direction of real axis. That point is minus 3. That point is minus 3. Automatically modulus is nothing but minus 3. Modulus is 3. This is the amplitude. Amplitude is pi. Amplitude is pi. You get cos pi plus I sin pi. You get cos pi plus I sin pi. This is the modulus amplitude of minus 3. Because 3 is the modulus, pi is the amplitude. Because this is the amplitude, which is pi. Because exactly 180 degrees. Similarly, we can get a complex number here in the negative direction of imaginary axis. And what is it? Suppose you take minus I. You take minus I. Minus I is automatically a complex number lying in the negative direction of y-axis, that is imaginary axis. Then this is the amplitude. This is the amplitude. So once that is the amplitude, once that is the amplitude, automatically modulus is 1. Modulus I 1. The word 1 into, you get cos 3 pi by 2 plus I sin 3 pi by 2. I sin 3 pi by 2. You can say this is the modulus amplitude form of minus I. So for any complex number,
whether it is in the first quadrant, second quadrant, third quadrant, fourth quadrant, or it lies on the positive direction of x-axis, positive direction of real axis, positive direction of imaginary axis, negative direction of real axis, negative direction of imaginary axis.
We can easily find modulus and amplitude form. Okay, now, with this idea, we are considering representation of product of two complex numbers in the arcade diagram. Product of two complex numbers in the arcade diagram. Z1 is a complex number R1 into cos theta 1 plus I sin theta 1, which means R1 is the modulus, theta 1 is the amplitude. Z2 is a complex number, R2 is a modulus, theta 2 is the amplitude. Then, if you find Z1, Z2, mathematically finding the product, R1, R2, we are grouping separately. Here, cos theta 1, cos theta 2. I sin theta 1, I sin theta 2. That is I square minus. So, we get cos theta 1, cos theta 2 minus sin theta 1, sin theta 2. Because I square is minus 1. Cos A, cos B minus sin A, sin B. Cos A plus B. Cos theta 1 plus theta 2. Similarly, imaginary parts, I into cos theta 1 sin theta 2 plus I into sin theta 1 cos theta 2. Therefore, I times sin theta 1 cos theta 2 plus cos theta 1 sin theta 2. So, that gives sin theta 1 plus theta 2. We get sin theta 1 plus theta 2. Therefore, Z1, Z2 is nothing but R1, R2 cos theta 1 plus theta 2, I sin theta 1 plus theta 2. What's the meaning of this? While finding the product, for the product, modulus is the product of the moduli. R1, R2 is nothing but mod Z1, mod Z2. The amplitude is nothing but sum of the amplitude. The amplitude of the product is the sum of the amplitudes. The amplitude of the product is nothing but sum of the amplitudes. Similarly, if you take a quotient Z1 by Z2, Z1 by Z2 is a quotient of two complex numbers, one divided by other, multiplied by the conjugate, simplified, we see that R1 by R2, grouping these two, and here this by this, multiplying conjugate and simplifying, you get cos theta 1 minus theta 2 plus I sin theta 1 minus theta 2. Therefore, while finding the quotient, the modulus of the quotient is nothing but the quotient of the moduli, the quotient of the moduli. The amplitude of the quotient is nothing but the difference between the amplitudes. Difference between the amplitudes. So therefore, the product, while finding the product, the amplitude becomes sum. While finding the quotient, the amplitude is nothing but the difference. So therefore, R1, R2, cos theta 1 plus theta 2 plus I sin theta 1 plus theta 2. Z1 by Z2 is R1 by R2 cos theta 1 minus theta 2 plus I sin theta 1 minus theta 2. Whereas, modulus of the product is equal to product of the moduli. Is nothing but the product of the moduli. And the modulus of the quotient is nothing but the quotient of the moduli. Quotient of the moduli. That is R1, R2 here, R1 by R2 here. And at the same time, the amplitude of Z1, Z2. We get the amplitude of Z1, Z2 is nothing but amplitude of Z1 plus amplitude of Z2. That is, amplitude of Z1 and Z2 is theta 1 plus theta 2. This is theta 1, this is theta 2. And the amplitude of Z1 by Z2, Z1 by Z2, is nothing but amplitude of Z1 minus amplitude of Z2. So, amplitude of the quotient is the difference of the amplitudes. Amplitude of the product is sum of the amplitudes. So, with this idea, with this concept, we can easily represent the product in the organ diagram, the quotient in the organ diagram. Let us see how. For that, Z1 is here, Z2 is here. We are representing Z1 and Z2. For Z1, automatically this is R1. We can draw a clear cut diagram. This is Z1. That means this is R1, this is theta 1. This is R1, this is theta 1. Z2 is here, this angle only up to this, this is not there, this is theta 2. this is theta 2. That is, when Z2 is here, this is the amplitude theta 2, this is modulus. So therefore, we are representing Z1 and Z2, this is R1, this is R2, this is theta 1, only this is theta 2. Like that. Now, after that, we are doing some construction. We are taking A on the real axis, thus that OA is 1 unit. I am drawing a big figure so that you can have a clear-cut idea. This is R1, this is theta 1. This is Z2, R2, theta 2. Okay. Now, you take a point A on the real axis, you join this, you call this as P, this is Q, right? OAP is a triangle for which OA is 1 unit, OP is R1 units. You take a point R in such a way, this is a construction. You take a point R in such a way, the triangle ORQ is similar to OAP. Similar, not congruent, it is similar. Corresponding sides are proportional. That is, that we are constructing a triangle ORQ in such a way, This triangle OPA and ORQ are similar. Corresponding sides are proportional. Therefore, OQ by OA, OR by OP, RQ by PA. So, accordingly, so automatically we can easily see that OR, we get OR by OP, OR by OP, is equal to OQ, is equal to OQ by OA, OQ by OA. So OA is 1 unit. Therefore, you get OR is equal to OP into OQ, OP into OQ. What is OP? That is R1, OQ is R2. Therefore, the point R is in such a way, OR is nothing but a modulus, that is nothing but R1, R2. That is nothing but the product of the moduli of two complex numbers Z1 and Z2. I repeat again, we are constructing a triangle in such a way, the two triangles are similar, corresponding sides are proportional, therefore I am taking OR by OP is OQ by OA. OA becomes 1, OA turns out to be 1, therefore OR is OP, OQ. You get out. Now, you take corresponding angles. Here it is theta 1, here it is theta 1, automatically it is theta 2. We can easily verify, this theta 1 plus theta 2, this theta 1, this is automatically theta 1, which is automatically theta 1. By construction, this is theta 1, this is theta 1. The whole angle will be theta 1 plus theta 2. Therefore, amplitude of this complex number is theta 1. See, I repeat again, this is theta 1 because this is theta 1 by proportional triangles. Then automatically, we can easily see that the whole angle is theta 2 plus theta 1. For R, theta 1 plus theta 2 is the amplitude. Therefore, R represents a complex number whose modulus is R1, R2 and amplitude is theta 1 plus theta 2. Therefore, if P is here, Q is here, then automatically the product will be here. And automatically it satisfies all conditions. Z1, Z2, Z1 plus Z2. Now we can easily represent a quotient in a similar way. In the sense, this by this gives this. If we take this as Z1, this as Z3, and this is nothing but this by this. Therefore, automatically Z3 by Z1 gives Z2. It is here. So, therefore, by similar way, we can, when this is the one is a 2. This is nothing but a quotient. This is nothing but a quotient. Therefore, this is Z1, this is Z2. This is Z2 by Z1. This is Z2 by Z1. Z1, Z2, Z2. This product gives this, this quotient gives this. So therefore, by similar way, we can represent product. The product is this, and the quotient of this by this is this. So this is quotient, this is the product. Okay. So we can represent product and quotient in the same figure without any difficulty. Okay. Another fundamental concept everyone should know. If n is a positive integer, that is De Moivre's theorem. A French mathematician, we call this as De Moivre's theorem. If n is a positive integer, cos theta plus I sin theta power n is cos theta plus I sin theta. If cos theta plus I sin theta power n is a positive integer, we can bring n here. This is cos n theta. We get cos n theta plus I sin n theta. Cos n theta plus I sin n theta. Even if n is a negative integer, cos theta plus I sin theta power n is cos n theta plus I sin n theta. N is missing here. Yes. This result can be applied. That is, cos theta plus I sin theta to the power n is nothing but cos n theta plus I sin n theta. If n is a positive integer, n is positive or negative integer, cos theta plus I sin theta power n is written as cos n theta plus I sin n theta. Cos theta plus I sin theta power 10 is cos 10 theta plus I sin 10 theta. Cos theta plus I sin theta power minus 10 is cos minus 10 theta plus I sin minus 10 theta. You can write like that. When n is positive, n is negative. But if n is of the form p by q, where p and q are integers, if n is rational, here we say n is a rational, it is of the form p by q, then cos p by q theta plus I sin p by q theta are nothing but cos n theta plus I sin n theta is one of the values of cos theta plus I sin theta power n. Now in the previous two cases, this is equal to this. Cos n theta plus I sin n theta is equal to this. Cos theta plus I sin theta power n. Whereas, cos n theta plus I sin n theta is one of the values of cos theta plus I sin theta power n. It has got many values, out of which this is one of the values. This is one of the values. This is possible only when n is rational. When n is rational, you must be very careful. Cos theta plus I sin theta power p by q is rational. One of the values is cos p by q theta plus I sin p by q theta. We can write many values, out of which this is one of the values. But in the previous two cases, cos n theta plus I sin n theta is the value of cos theta plus I sin theta power n. This is precisely De Moivre's theorem. De Moivre's theorem has got wonderful applications. I'll repeat again. We can write cos theta. Some examples we'll give. Cos theta plus I sin theta power 11, we can write this as cos 11 theta plus I sin 11 theta. Cos theta plus I sin theta power minus 7 is cos minus 7 theta. Cos minus theta is cos theta itself. Sin minus 7 theta is minus I sin 7 theta. Applying the trigonometric result, you can write cos theta plus I sin theta power minus 7 is cos 7 theta minus I sin 7 theta. Whereas, if we take cos theta plus I sin theta power 3 by 4 is a rational number, then we simply say cos 3 by 4 theta plus I sin 3 by 4 theta is one of the values, that's very important, one of the values it has got many values. After this, one of the values of cos theta plus I sin theta power 3 by 4. One of the values of cos theta plus I sin theta power 3 by 4. When it becomes one of the values, when the power is nothing but a rational number. Cos 3 by 4 theta plus I sin 3 by 4 theta is one of the values of cos theta plus I sin theta power 3 by 4. Yes. This is precisely our De Moivre theorem. We can solve. We are solving problems, many problems under De Moivre theorem. But anyhow, we will take some concepts behind it. Okay. Let us take cube roots of unity in detail. First, we take cube roots of unity. This is very, very important. Cube roots of unity. Okay, what do you mean by cube roots of unity? X is equal to 1 power 1 by 3. Solving x is equal to 1 power 1 by 3, we get the cube roots of unity. You get that. That is, the power is 1 by 3, we get 3 roots for this equation. When power is 1 by 3, power is p by q, the power is p by q, we get q values. We get q roots or q values for that equation. So here, x is equal to 1 power 1 by 3 gives us x cubed is equal to 1. X cubed is equal to 1 can be factorized. X minus 1, x square plus x plus 1 is equal to 0. This gives x is equal to 1, one of the roots which is real. And solving this quadratic equation, you get minus b plus or minus root 3 I by 2. Applying that formula, minus b plus or minus root of b square minus 4ac by 2a, we get minus 1 plus or minus root 3 I by 2. Two roots are imaginary. One is a real root. So therefore, out of three roots, one is purely real, other two are imaginary. So therefore, these values are called cube roots of unity. Therefore, what are the cube roots of unity? 1 is 1 root. Minus 1 plus root 3i by 2 is another root. Minus 1 minus root 3i by 2 gives third root. We all simply call this as 1 omega omega square. We simply call this as 1 omega omega square. That means, if you call this as omega, squaring this, you get this. Squaring this, we get this. You can also call this as omega, this is omega square. Or this as omega, this is omega square. Both are equal. So, 1 omega omega square are nothing but cube roots of unity. Now, our question is, cube roots of unity can be plotted in the organ diagram. By plotting cube roots of unity in the organ diagram, we get lot of points. What are the points? What are the inference? How to make lot of inference from this? So for that, I am taking the organ diagram. One, I am marking it here. Minus 1 plus root 3i by 2 is the next root. It is in the second quadrant. Coordinates are minus half root 3 by 2. So this is one point. We call that as 3. We know minus half minus root 3 by 2. Minus half minus root 3 by 2 is the third root. It is nothing but a reflection of this, because minus 1 plus root 3i by 2, this is minus 1 minus root 3i by 2. Conjugate, this is the conjugate of this. Conjugate means it's a reflection with respect to a real axis. So you join like this. So you take a point P here, you take a point Q here, you take a point R here, you join these lines.
Cube roots of unity are represented by 3 points. One is R, here it is minus half plus root 3 by 2. Another point is minus half minus root 3 by 2, which is the conjugate of this point. We can easily verify that the distance of R from O is 1 unit. Distance of P from O is 1 unit because root of half square plus root 3 by 2 whole square, root of 1 by 4, 3 by 4, 1. Similarly, this distance is also 1. The distance of each cube root of unity from the origin is 1. That's the meaning of cube root of unity. 1, 1, 1. Distance is 1, this is 1, this is 1. We can easily see that the distance between P and R, distance this is 1, 0, this is 1, 0. 1 plus half 3 by 2 whole square minus. So here the distance PR we are finding. The distance PR, applying the distance formula, 1 minus half minus half minus half 3 by 2, you get 9 by 4. 0 root 3 by 2, you get 3 by 4. You get root of 12 by 4 root 3. So the distance is root 3. Automatically root 3 by 2, root 3 by 2, root 3, this is root 3. Now we can easily see that this is an equilateral triangle, or in other words, cube roots of unity in the organ diagram forms an equilateral triangle with side root 3, with side root 3. So root 3 stands for the equilateral triangle, side of the equilateral triangle PQR. We can also see that the centroid of the triangle PQR, centroid means x1 plus x2 plus x3 by 3, minus half, plus 1, 0 by 3, you get 0. Root 3 by 2, minus root 3 by 2, 0, 0, so you get 0, 0. So therefore, we can easily see that centroid of the triangle is the origin. Centroid of the triangle PQR is the origin. Since it is the origin, so we know for any equilateral triangle, if this is the centroid, if this is the centroid, this is 120, this is 120, this is 120, total will be 360. Therefore, we are getting a lot of inference. We are getting inference. One inference is the modulus of this is 1, amplitude. The amplitude of this complex number is 0. The amplitude of 1, 0 is 0. Whereas, this is the amplitude of this complex number, which is nothing but 120, which is 2 pi by 3. 2 pi by 3. The amplitude of third complex number, which is nothing but this one, 2 pi by 3 plus 2 pi by 3, 4 pi by 3, that gives the amplitude of this one. So therefore, we come to a conclusion. The 1 omega omega square or the cube roots of unity, they are in geometric progression. Why? Omega is the common ratio. The amplitudes are, 0, 2 pi by 3, 4 pi by 3. Adding 2 pi by 3 we get this, adding 2 pi by 3 we get this. They are in arithmetic progression. Therefore, cube roots of unity form a geometric progression. Their amplitudes are in arithmetic progression with a common difference 2 pi by 3. Common difference 2 pi by 3. Modulus, here modulus is 1. Modulus of each cube root of unity, distance from the origin is 1 unit. Centroid is at the origin. Equilateral triangle with side root 3. At the same time, if PQR are the 3 points, if it draw a circle unit circle, center and origin radius 1 unit, x square plus y square is equal to 1, or mod z is equal to 1. Mod z also represents unit circle, mod z is equal to 1. So therefore, they are all lying on a unit circle, mod z is equal to 1. Cube roots of unity form the equilateral triangle, centroid at the origin, they are all lying on a unit circle, mod z is equal to 1. Mod z is equal to 1. Perimeter 3 root 3, all the 6 can be inferred. Amplitudes are 0, 2 pi by 3, 4 pi by 3. They are in arbitrary progression, and 1 omega omega square, they are in geometric progression. Now, some more information. X cubed minus 1 is equal to 0, cube roots of unity, gives cube roots of unity, 1 omega omega square. Some of the roots taken one at a time. 1 plus omega square, coefficient of x square minus coefficient of x square by coefficient of x cube, 0. So sum of the cube roots of unity is always equal to 0, sum of the cube roots of unity. What is the product? Product of the cube roots of unity, 1 omega omega square, omega cube is equal to 1, omega, because omega satisfies this equation, therefore omega cube is equal to 1. So, product of the roots gives us 1, sum of the roots gives us 0. Sum of the roots gives us 0. Now, is there any other inference from this cube roots of unity discussion? I have given almost all our important results for combat examination. Product of the cube roots of unity is omega cubed, that is 1. Product of the imaginary cube roots of unity, only these two are imaginary, that is also equal to 1. So the product of imaginary cube roots of unity is only these two are imaginary, omega omega square. You can easily see that one is the conjugate or other, one is the conjugate or other, right? One is the reflection. The product is 1, the product of imaginary roots is also 1. How many real roots? Only one real root. How many imaginary roots? Two imaginary roots. Sum is 0. Product is 1. So these are the this is very important discussion regarding cube roots of unity. Okay. Coming to fourth roots of unity. We'll generalize. Cube roots, fourth roots, fifth roots, generalize nth roots. Fourth roots of unity. Fourth roots of unity. X is equal to 1 power 1 by 4. That is x power 4 is equal to 1. That is x power 4 minus 1 is equal to 0. That is x square minus 1, x square plus 1 is equal to 0. X is equal to plus or minus 1, x square is minus 1, I square, therefore x square is equal to I square minus 1, therefore x is equal to plus or minus I, therefore fourth roots of unity are 1 minus 1, I minus I. So fourth roots of unity can be obtained as 1 minus 1, I minus I. These are the fourth roots of unity. So you must know what are the cube roots, what are the fourth roots. Cube roots of unity are 1 minus 1 plus root 3 I by 2 minus 1 minus root 3 I by 2. Fourth roots of unity are 1 minus 1 I minus I. We are drawing inferences from this. We can mark fourth roots of unity in the arc diagram. We can mark 1 here, we can mark I here, we can mark minus 1 here, we can mark minus I here. So fourth roots of unity, 1 minus 1, I minus I. They form PQRS. The vertices of a square
or rhombus, because the diagonals bisect each other, all four sides are equal. It's, we can say it's a square. They call, can also call this as a rhombus. PQRS, fourth roots of unity, form a rhombus or a square. We can say it forms a rhombus bar square. We can also say it's a square. Now, it's a regular square. Regular figure means all four sides are equal. Cube roots of unity, they form a regular triangle. Regular triangle means all three sides are equal, equilateral triangle. Here, 1, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1. Root of 1 square plus 1 square, root 2. So, root 2 is each side. Each side is root 2. Root 2, root 2, root 2, root 2. Since it's a square, area is root 2 square, 2 square units. Area is 2 square units. Perimeter 4 root 2. Perimeter 4 root 2. Now we have found the area, we have found the perimeter, they form a square, they form a rhombus, centroid is at the origin, centroid x1 plus x2 plus x3 plus x4 by 4, centroid is at the origin. Now our next question is, can you represent fourth roots of unity in this form? That is very, very important discussion. Can you write fourth roots of unity in the form 1 omega, omega square, omega cube? Yes, the answer is yes, because we are taking omega as I square, I cube. What is I square? I square is minus 1. I cubed is minus I. Again, we are getting 4, 1 minus 1, I minus I. Therefore, we can represent the fourth roots of unity as 1 omega, omega square, omega cube, where omega is nothing but I. Omega is nothing but I. Very simple question. Okay, next. We are marking 1 here. I here, minus 1 here, minus I here. By marking like this, here amplitude becomes 0, here amplitude becomes pi by 2, here amplitude becomes pi, here amplitude becomes 3 pi by 2. The amplitude roots are 1 omega, omega square, omega cube. The amplitudes are 1. The amplitude, I am writing amplitude. Amplitude of omega, this I is pi by 2. Here amplitude is pi. Here it is 3 pi by 2. Now for understanding, 1 omega, omega square, omega cube. I am writing amplitude as 1, pi by 2, pi by 2, pi, 3 pi by 2. If you want, you can write this as 2 pi by 4. 4 pi by 4, 6 pi by 4. In cube roots of unity, denominator we obtained at 3, 3, 3. 1, 2 pi by 3, 4 pi by 3. Here we are having 2 pi by 4, 4 pi by 4, 6 pi by 4. So these are the amplitudes. These are the amplitudes. The difference is 2 pi by 4. Adding 2 pi by 4, we get this. So the amplitudes are in arithmetic progression. The roots are in, fourth roots are in geometric progression. It's always there in all the results. All the nth roots of unity, it is like that. They are forming geometric progression. Amplitudes form arithmetic progression. So fourth roots of unity, you get 4, 4, 4. Fifth roots of unity, you get 5, 5, 5. Sixth roots of unity, you get 6, 6, 6. You can easily verify.
nth root of everything, you write n, n, n.
So we can easily get the rhythm. Once you get the rhythm, you can enjoy carefully everything in the arc and diagram. Okay, so these are the important results of our fourth roots of unity. Next class, we will take fifth roots of unity, sixth roots of unity, and with that, we will generalize nth roots of unity.